Good morning. What follows is information about how we created our program to fulfill the tribal component of the Power Act, why we chose to focus on the issue of vanishing Native American women, and what the specifics are for our September 20th program. The goal here is to present information that other districts can duplicate. And during my brief remarks, I'll talk about what's happening here in Washington, and then you will hear from Professor Deer, who will cover this issue more in depth. So here is the specific language of the Power Act that was just discussed by Chief Martinez. And as Ninth Circuit representatives, we are the chief's designees in our district to plan these programs. So why we chose to focus on the issue of vanishing Native American women comes directly from our research. The first law in Washington State to deal with this issue passed in 2018. And it directed the state patrol to conduct a study to outreach to tribes and to submit that study to the legislature by June 1st of this year. Captain Monica Alexander, who the chief referenced, who's part of our program, submitted that report on June 1st. And I'll provide a little bit more about what she'll cover and our CLE set for September 20th. So in its report, the Washington State Patrol found more than 4 in 5 American Indian and Alaskan Native women and men have experienced violence in their lifetime, and more than 1 in 3 experienced violence in the past year. Other major findings from the report include Native women living on tribal lands are murdered at an extremely high rate, more than 10 times the national average, that no federal agency has comprehensive data on how many indigenous women are missing, and that tribes here in Washington State do not have data on their murdered and missing women, especially if that happened on their tribal land. Our research has led us to more information that's within the circuit, but outside of the state of Washington. In Montana alone, Native people accounted for 30% of the missing women and girls in the time period of July 2017, despite making up just 3% of the population. And in April 2019, 3 United States senators from within the Ninth Circuit introduced a bipartisan bill called the Not Invisible Act of 2019. It was introduced by John Tester of Montana, Lisa Murkowski of Alaska, and Catherine Cortez Masto of Nevada. The bill seeks to address what the Indian Law Resource Center calls a lack of diligent and adequate federal response to the issue of vanishing Native American women. To create our Power Act compliance program, we began by researching activities that involve tribes and tribal issues within our state. The variety of sources that we consulted include all 3 branches of government and the 4th estate, including newspapers and newspaper archives. What we discovered was an abundance of information, and this data can apply to most districts across the Ninth Circuit. It's from state legislation to organizations that have websites that share data about tribes. For example, there are over 140,000 Native citizens living in Washington State alone. And as Chief Martinez pointed out, we have 29 federally recognized tribes in Washington State. However, we have 3 tribes, the Duwamish, the Wanapum, and the Chinook, are not recognized by the federal government, but they have a long-standing history in present-day Washington. For those of you unfamiliar with our state, this is a map of Washington. It's helpful to locate where you are in relation to our largest city, Seattle, on the west side of the state. You'll note in the southwest of the map, the city of Olympia, that's our state capital. And in northeast Washington lies Spokane, where we are today. And the areas in red are the Indian reservations. Where the green runs north to south, that's roughly the dividing line between the Western District of Washington and the Eastern District. This is a map that encompasses the Plateau Indian lands, and the Spokane tribe inhabited the eastern portion of present-day Washington State. This is a reference to the Indian reservations in the continental United States provided by the Bureau of Indian Affairs. The dots represent Indian reservations. This is that same map with the Ninth Circuit drawn around those states within our circuit on the continent. And as you can see, a large portion of the tribal reservations are in our circuit. This map shows the federally recognized tribes in Washington State provided by the Governor's Office of Indian Affairs. And by comparison, this map shows all the tribes of Washington State, both recognized and unrecognized, in their native language. This map was provided by permission courtesy of Tribal Nations Maps. And the most recent legislation to deal with this issue happened earlier this year. Washington Governor Jay Inslee signed a bill that creates a pair of liaisons within the state patrol to work with tribes and deal with the cases of missing Native American women and to develop best practices for handling these cases. These next few slides are photographs from the signing of the legislation that occurred on April 24th. This law goes into effect in 6 days on July 28th, 2019. This is a photo taken during the bill signing. You'll see here the Macaw Indian tribe holding a poster noting the murder of a fellow tribal member. This is Governor Inslee receiving an honoring blanket by the Confederated Tribes of the Colville, and you'll note that the Colville tribe is very near where we are today. And this photo symbolizes the concern from our Native citizens that this issue be addressed. This is a long-standing problem. This is nothing new. It's just starting to gain attention here, though. And we, as pro bono attorneys, have a role across the Ninth Circuit to shed light on the issue through the Power Act and help with bringing pro bono services to Native tribes while also highlighting the issue of vanishing Native American women. This is the Colville tribe again at the signing ceremony. So here's how we apply our findings to create the Tribal Power Act. We focus on the issue of vanishing Native American women. We educate our legal community on the issue and how to provide pro bono services on tribal lands. And then we've utilized a four-panel approach. So we have subject matter experts, trial lawyers who work with tribes, legislative stakeholders, and then our judiciary. So here's an overview. So on September 20th at our courthouse in the Western District, we'll start off with two subject matter experts. Those two are Abigail Echohawk. She is the director of the Urban Indian Health Institute, and she'll be presenting with Professor Angela Riley from UCLA, who teaches on this topic. Then Captain Monica Alexander, who you've heard about, will be our second panel, and she'll talk about her June 1st report to the legislature. Then we have a pro bono panel of attorneys that work with tribes who will discuss the needs for pro bono work as it relates to domestic violence on tribal lands. And then we'll end with our judicial panel, which our chief just referred to, which will be Chief Martinez, Judge Morgan Kristen from the Ninth Circuit, and Judge Rosanna Peterson from the Eastern District of Washington. We're actively working on materials as takeaway for our lawyer representatives who want to provide pro bono services. And here are the takeaways. So look for the following organizations in your state and in your district. There are Office of Indian Affairs similar to Washington State. There are law schools. The two law schools in the Western District of Washington both have some kind of Indian Law Resource Center. look to legal aid organizations. The Federal Legal Services Corporation makes grants specifically for service to Native Americans. Every state in the circuit has at least one such grantee. Look to your local bar associations, the U.S. Attorney's Office. There are DOJ-funded DV programs. They make grants to state and tribal governments and nonprofit entities for domestic violence programs. And remember, under the Power Act, we can collaborate. So think of how you could reach out to other districts. And if any of you would like to collaborate with us, feel free to contact me or any of our Ninth Circuit lawyer representatives. There are 9 of us, and we'd be happy to discuss it with you. This is the acknowledgments of what I would like to thank those who helped make our September 20th program possible. And as you read the acknowledgments, I just want to leave you with one thought that I came across yesterday. It's a quote by Stephen Hawking. He's the English theoretical physicist who died in March of 2018. And he says, "Let us fight for every woman and every man to have the opportunity to live healthy, secure lives, full of opportunity and love. We are all time travelers, journeying together into the future, but let us work together to make that future a place we want to visit. Be brave, be curious, be determined, overcome the odds. It can be done." Thank you. Professor Beard.
Hins je silo ijo chaho tifgados, amalegida ikitlax, tlaplako amidalwados, hoktagi aja yija stichadi chaho tifgados, ahagahaya agadichit mahayados, University of Kansas mahayados, Lawrence, Kansas amalegados. Good morning, and thank you for allowing me to be here this morning. I'm going to share a lot of really distressing information with you in a very quick way in an effort to move forward and give you the good news. So I want to start with the data that we do have, and this is from the Federal Department of Justice, namely the National Institute of Justice, which published an important report called American Indians and Crime in 2016. Concluding that over 84% of Native women have experienced some form of violence in their lifetimes. And over 56% of Native women have experienced some form of sexual violence in their lifetime. And this is more than 1 in 2 Native women. So the majority of us will experience sexual assault at some point in our lifetime. In some areas where it is estimated that the rate of post-traumatic stress disorder among Native people is over 4 times the national average. In terms of our Native Two-Spirit relatives, that's our LGBTQ relatives, almost 30% report that they have been victims of a hate crime. And 85% of lesbian and bisexual and Two-Spirit women have experienced some form of sexual violence. This violence that we are experiencing is occurring both on and off tribal lands. So the urban experience in Seattle showed very, very similar rates of violence in the urban areas, namely in Seattle of Washington State. One very important statistic that a lot of people don't know about is the fact that unusually, Native people experience crime at the hands of people who are not Native. And that's a very unusual statistic in American criminology. Most of the time in this country, statistically, the perpetrator and the victim are of the same race. The only exception to that general rule is Native people. This is from the Department of Justice report from 2016. Over 90% of Native people, both men and women, report that they've had at least one perpetrator who is non-Indian. Now, this is not to say that Native people don't commit crimes as well. They absolutely do. Native people hurt each other every single day. But it's important from a statistical and legal standpoint to acknowledge the high rate of non-Indian crime that's being perpetrated against Native people. Why? Because the jurisdiction of the tribal courts and the tribal police are limited. There are only narrow exceptions that allow tribal police and tribal courts to exercise criminal jurisdiction over non-Indians. Only in cases of domestic violence is that allowed. So child sex abuse, homicide, rape, if it's committed by a non-Indian, the tribal court will have no jurisdiction pursuant to the 1978 Supreme Court decision in Oliphant versus Suquamish. I present to a lot of different kinds of audiences, and I'm sure that I don't need to tell a room of federal judges what sovereignty means. But we have to think about the fact that tribal sovereignty, unlike state and federal sovereignty, is questionable in many circumstances. And that many times tribal nations are fighting for the very little sovereignty that remains based on federal intervention in the legal system. But essentially, we're talking about the inherent power of a government to exercise its own jurisdiction, to exercise its own laws, make laws, and be governed by them. But I've worked with rape survivors for over 25 years now. And one of the things that I've come to know about rape survivors is that we also have a sense that our sovereignty has been violated. The sense of self, the sense of power, the sense of identity is very much under attack during a sexual assault. And so sometimes when you're talking about Native women in particular, we're experiencing violations of our tribal sovereignty and violations of our own personal sense of safety and sovereignty. Now, I think it's critical to put this all in a historical context. My grandfather, my Native grandfather, was very insistent that we know our history. And so I get a lot of calls right now from journalists, anywhere from a small local publication to the New York Times, asking me why. Why is it that Native people experience such high rates of violence? When did this start? How come we don't know about this? And what I always tell them is that although it's not always possible in a short news article, we have to think about the historical context if we really want to understand why this crisis exists. So one of the things that I began studying as a law student, then continued as a legal scholar and activist, is the fact that violent crime is relatively new in the sense of being as significant and as common as it is today. Many of our tribes were matrilineal, not matriarchal, I think is overstating it, but women were very much centered in our tribal cultures. We had political rights. In fact, one of the things that was very frustrating to tribal nations when we began to treat with European nations and with the United States is they oftentimes wouldn't listen to the Native women. They would only treat with the Native men. And so the whole political power that Native women had as equal participants in the political life of a tribe were diminished merely by the contact that we had with Europe and with the United States. When I started studying this issue in law school, I had been a rape crisis advocate for many years at that point. It was one of the reasons I went to law school. And I began studying the intersection of my own tribal nation's history. And this is the Muscogee Creek Nation of Oklahoma, the language that I spoke to you at the beginning. And one of the things that I wanted to learn about in law school was how my tribal nation or my tribal culture had responded to violence when it occurred within our tribe. Unfortunately, we didn't have a written language until the late 18th, early 19th century. So there weren't archives of our tribe that I could go back and study. There weren't interviews that were recorded with elders or with knowledge bearers or with tribal legal bearers that I could go to. So one of the things that I had to be satisfied with is observations made by Europeans and Americans about tribal people, particularly around gendered violence. And that's when I came across the journals of William Bartram, who was a Quaker naturalist who lived among the Creek and Cherokee people before removal, so we were still in the southeastern part of the United States, between basically in the late 18th century. He was down there to sort of start categorizing plant and animal life. But he lived among Creek and Cherokee people for over a decade in that project that he was engaged in. And one of the things that he would do is he'd write letters to his friends who were curious about Native people. He also kept his own journals. And one of the things that he remarked upon several times in his work is the fact that he really didn't see gendered violence as a significant problem. Now, it may be that he didn't have access to that kind of information, but his observations are here when he said, "I never saw or heard, again, in a decade, an instance of an Indian beating his wife or other female, or even speaking to her disrespectfully." That led my research to the next finding, and that was I discovered that our tribe had a rape law in 1824. Now, this is very, very early to think about a tribe having a rape law. But we were heavily assimilated at this point. We were largely Christianized very early. We were largely intermarried with Scottish immigrants. And so we had a lot of Western influence in our tribe at this point. And our Indian agent told us that if we truly wanted to be one of the quote-unquote civilized tribes, we would need to reduce our oral traditions, our oral laws, to writing. And we would need to do it in English, even though most of the tribe didn't speak English. So this law was written down in longhand by the son of one of the chiefs, and his name was Chili McIntosh. Now, I often say in talking about this issue that I'm very envious of tribal leaders from other tribes, particularly in the plains, that have these revered, very powerful names like Crazy Horse and Sitting Bull, and I turn to my tribe and I have Chili McIntosh. So that's what I can, you know, that's the proud name that I can give you. But one of the things, obviously, that I want you to notice about this law is that it's very victim-centered, in fact, very gendered-centered, and that in our law, even though we had been assimilated, and even though that we had been going down the path of quote-unquote civilizing ourselves, something pre-colonial was maintained here, because the rest of the laws sort of looked like they were cut and pasted from state laws, the rest of our criminal law in 1824. Here, though, we see something that you wouldn't find in Anglo-American law in 1824, and that is an acknowledgement of the victim, acknowledgement of gender, and the acknowledgement that gender plays a role in these kinds of crimes, and more than ever, more than the most remarkable part, of course, is what she say it be law. Now, I'm not suggesting that we need to bring this law back. It wouldn't work in the contemporary setting in tribal or federal courts. But it's worth noting that violence against Native women was taken seriously and that gender was dealt with differently by tribal people. So I come back to this question: what factors explain the disproportionate amount of violence in the United States against Native people? So if we know that today we have the highest rate of violence, but at one point we had lower rates of violence, what explains that story? And I believe if we can understand what explains that story, we can start to stop or stem the tide of this incredibly high and unacceptable rate of violence. So I talk about a few examples of how sexual assault became part and parcel of the Native experience in this country. And I have to start with Columbus, who is symbolically a problem, right? So we have protests against Columbus Day. It represents Western imperialism. But the other thing that we have to acknowledge that is that rape came from Europe. Rape as a weapon of war came from Europe. And so in 1495, we see one of Columbus's shipmates bragging about the physical sexual assault of a Native woman nearly at the point when he steps off the boat for the first time. And so if we remove that historical context and we say, oh, well, we just learned in the late 90s that Native women are being raped at high rates, we're missing that whole history, that whole historical context. The other thing that we have to understand is that many of the federal policies, the unfortunate and sad federal policies that were imposed upon Native people, were embedded with a form of sexual violence. So my people were forced west on the Trail of Tears. Most people are familiar with the Cherokee story of the Trail of Tears, but there are actually five nations that were removed west against our will, and one of them was the Creek Nation. So this map shows you that it's more than one trail and probably a lot more than tears are involved. One of the things that I've learned in my research is that Native people, Native women were raped on these journeys. We were at the mercy of the soldiers. We did not have many legal rights, and nobody was ever prosecuted for these crimes. This is a picture of some Diné or Navajo women in the southwest part of the United States who were also forcibly marched from one place to another. And these women, we don't know much about them, but it's very likely, since they were under control of the U.S. military, that they too had experienced sexual violence. The boarding school era of the United States also instituted sexual violence on a mass scale. The boarding school era was intended to civilize our children, but it just punished them for being Indian. In fact, the motto of the leader of the boarding school era, Henry Pratt, said that the goal was to kill the Indian and save the man. And so this is the same group of children just a few months after they were captured. This is the before. Oops, let's go back. Before, same group of children after. And so the goal was to eliminate all of our identity, all of our indigenous ways of living and ways of thinking, but it also did include sexual violence as well. I'm going to move to some good news because I just have a few minutes left. All right. So one of the things that I think is really important, because those statistics that I showed you, those red numbers that I showed you, can be so dehumanizing, right? Because we're not seeing the faces of Native people. We're seeing numbers. And so I think it's important for me to balance that by saying that we are not passive victims. We are not simply accepting this way of life. Starting back in 1883, the very first Native woman to write a book in the United States, Sarah Winnemucca Paiute, spoke repeatedly in her writings about sexual violence. And so we have not just been quiet victims. There have been two significant pieces of legislation that have passed. One was the Tribal Law and Order Act of 2010. And President Obama signed this law in the East Room of the White House, but he was introduced by a Native woman named Lisa Marie Ayotte, who spoke about the rape that she experienced on the Rosebud Reservation in the mid-1990s. When she reported this crime immediately after, the federal prosecutors declined to get involved because the attacker had not used a weapon. The Tribal Law and Order Act changed that and mandated that federal prosecutors account for their participation in addressing crime in Indian country. We passed the Violence Against Women Act in 2013, the reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act, and Diane Millich spoke, a woman from the Ute tribe. She was assaulted repeatedly by her non-Indian husband for several years. In fact, at one point, he did fire a gun in her direction at her workplace. Neither the tribal government nor the state government had jurisdiction over him, and he was able to continue perpetrating his crimes until he was finally arrested for the gunshot in her direction. We've also, as a Native group of Native women attorneys, we've been addressing some of the concerns that we have found at the U.S. Supreme Court with cases that have an impact on us, cases that matter to us. So we filed amicus briefs in cases like the Dollar General case of 2015, which ended in a tie vote after Justice Scalia died in February 2016. That case involved the child sexual abuse on the Mississippi Choctaw Reservation. The tribe could not prosecute the white manager of the Dollar General store who molested one of their Choctaw children because he was non-Indian. The family filed a civil lawsuit against the corporation in tribal court. Dollar General protested that jurisdiction all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. We filed a brief explaining what was at stake. Not only then would, if Dollar General won that case, not only would we not be able to prosecute non-Indians who commit these crimes, we also would not be able to sue them. The court could not reach a consensus, so we dealt with a 4-4 tie. At the lower court in the Fifth Circuit, the tribe had won that case, and so at least for that circuit, that becomes the precedent. We also filed a brief in United States versus Bryant in that same term that dealt with the federal habitual offender statute. We had a Native man who had committed over 100 crimes at the tribal court level, but he just wasn't getting the lesson learned. So the habitual offender statute allowed a federal prosecutor to use two of those prior tribal court convictions as predicate offenses. He protested that, saying he didn't have counsel at the tribal court level. That was a unanimous decision in favor of the government. The more recent ones, we filed a brief in Gamble because we were concerned about the dual sovereignty doctrine as it applies to tribes and the federal government. That wasn't addressed within the decision itself, but we wanted to make sure the court kept in mind that the dual sovereign doctrine also applies to tribal nations. And we've also filed a brief in Carpenter versus Murphy, which actually is a very interesting case because Gorsuch is recused from that case. So we are again left with eight justices in a pivotal Indian law case. It has to do with the boundaries of my own tribe's reservation in the state of Oklahoma. We had oral arguments in November. The court has not reached a decision. In fact, they have asked for a re-argument next term. We are as Native women, arguing that tribal jurisdictional boundaries need to stay, need to be unchanged, so that tribes have the ultimate maximum territorial authority they need to protect women and children. So while I start with the red statistics and I start with the numbers that are so distressing, I think it's important to understand that Native people are not passive. We are not defined by these statistics. We're defined by what we do about them. So this is my contact information. I say mado to you, which is my way of saying thank you in our language. It's a very big honor and privilege to be asked to speak to this kind of group, and so I really thank you for your attention. If there's anything I can do to provide more information about this issue to you, I would be more than honored to do so. Thank you.
Hi, so I'm Nicole Nelson, and I'm the Executive Director of Alaska Legal Services. And I'm here today to talk with you about how the legal profession can help stop domestic violence and why we should. And so there are five things I'd like you to take away from today. One, that domestic violence is a staggering problem within all of our communities, and that civil legal representation is an effective intervention. But due to the systemic underfunding of civil legal aid organizations, most people who can't afford an attorney aren't able to get the civil representation they need. So there's a desperate need for volunteers to help with this ongoing community crisis, and there's a lot of support within the legal aid community to help support those who would want to volunteer. So before we get into all of that, I want to set the stage and tell you a little bit about my organization, my community, the landscape in which we work, and how we operate and get the job done. And I think this will help us sort of as a case study for those of you who are working in other states. So first off, for over 50 years, Alaska Legal Services has been Alaska's only statewide provider of civil legal aid for those who can't afford it. We help people protect their property, their safety, their health, and their livelihoods. And we are very much like other LSC-funded organizations throughout the Ninth Circuit. However, we have a special expertise, as you might imagine, in rural service delivery, and also because and also addressing the legal needs that are unique and specific to our Alaska Native brothers and sisters. In any given year, 45% of Alaska Legal Services clients are Alaska Native, and we also represent smaller tribes who can't afford an attorney. We receive our funding, part of our funding, from the Federal Legal Services Corporation, which provides financial support to civil legal aid organizations in every state and the territories. And these funds are distributed to legal aid organizations based on their percentage of the poverty population. We serve our community through 12 offices that are scattered throughout our state and 6 medical legal partnerships. The medical legal partnerships are where we embed a legal aid attorney, in our case, in the tribal healthcare system. Our annual budget supports a total of about 60 employees, only 35 of which are attorneys. And they are charged with serving a poverty population of over 100,000 and that are scattered across an expanse that is greater than Montana, California, and Texas combined. So, the quick facts about Alaska that you may know, again, I said it's vast. It's bigger than the next 3 states. It has an extremely low population density. There are only 750,000 of us, and again, we are home to 229 tribes. That's about 40% of all the indigenous communities in the U.S., and about 18% of the overall population of Alaska is Alaska Native, and most of our communities are not road connected. 82% are not road connected. So this distance and geography present extreme service delivery challenges for everyone in our state who's trying to serve the communities. Most of our communities are not accessible, are only accessible by boat, plane, or snow machine. And those communities that are off the road system are also most often between 80 and 90% of indigenous communities. There's a lack of infrastructure. Including law enforcement infrastructure. There's at least 75 villages with no law enforcement at all, and there's no regular access to police or courts in most of those communities. If you'll look at this, the red line represents where the road system is and the ferry system. So if you'll remember, this story map shows where the density of lawyers by zip code is within our community. And it shows that the private lawyers are represented in blue, and the green dots show where the public resources are, and that would be the public defenders, Alaska Legal Services, and the court system. And you can see that most of the legal resources, both public and private, are located along where the road system would be. And that's leaving our most remote communities without legal access. Recently, our State Access to Justice Commission conducted a social network analysis to help understand what happened when people sought out help with their legal problems. And from this analysis, the commission learned that Alaska Legal Services was the most referred to entity in the state. When people had a legal problem, they came to us, more so than the courts, than the self-help center, or the public defender's office, or the police. And I'm proud of this. It says to me that we are a trusted community resource, and we know that people can come to us for help, and we'll help them when we can. But unfortunately, we are the least resourced player in the state. Last year, we were able to stretch our resources to serve 7,500 people in 197 different communities, 90% of which were off the road system. So you may ask, how were we able to do that? And the answer is, we had a lot of help from our friends. We partnered with social service providers like domestic violence shelters and those addressing homelessness and other social services in the state, and those are represented by the orange dots. And we also built a referral network and embedded our services within the tribal healthcare system. And the tribal healthcare system within Alaska has the most expansive infrastructure and reach of anyone in our state. But because we have so few resources, we have to prioritize them and choose which cases and where we'll be able to help. And we do this by listening to our community and also choosing those places or looking to those things where we know lawyers can make a difference. So in communities across Alaska, if you are listening to your community and you cannot help but hear that people need help with respect to the needs of those experiencing domestic violence. With stats that say 1 out of 2 women in Alaska have experienced domestic violence or sexual assault, and again, our Alaska Native sisters are heavily overrepresented in those numbers, you can't help but recognize it's a problem, and it's personal. It can't help but be a friend, a neighbor, a colleague, your family. And the violence in these cases is sometimes and oftentimes life-threatening. So it's not surprising, then, that assisting families experiencing domestic violence is a very high priority for Alaska Legal Services. They're a priority for us not just because of the need, but because we know we can make a difference. And we know this anecdotally from our work over the last 50 years, but we also know it from decades worth of national studies that support that. Lawyers help those experiencing domestic violence by getting orders of protection. Again, Chief Judge Martinez mentioned this before, that 83% of those represented by an attorney were successful in getting a protective order, as opposed to 32% who were not granted a protective order. And what's interesting about this, too, is that the women who were granted those protective orders, 70% of those people who were granted protective orders said that it helped their partners understand that what they were doing, their actions were wrong. And 87% of the women who were granted protective orders said it was effective at stopping abuse. We also know that lawyers can make a difference in addressing collateral issues attendant to domestic violence that often make separating from an abusive relationship impossible. Lawyers can help with financial abuse. They can help stabilize income. And they can also help prevent there are legal remedies to help prevent homelessness. In any given year, half of the homeless women and children in communities are experiencing domestic violence. And the number one reason that people give when they return from an emergency shelter and go back to an abusive situation is because they have a lack of alternative housing arrangements. So we know this. We know that there are civil legal remedies that will protect against abuse, strengthen financial position, get custody of children, and empower women to end abusive relationships. Lawyers work, and they make a big difference. But the sad fact is, despite the fact that we have created an infrastructure through strong community partnerships that can connect us through this vast state to even the most remotely located people who need our help, and even though we know that legal aid helps end domestic violence, we are overwhelmed by the demand for our services. In the last year, we had to turn away one person for everyone that came to our door. And this is only the people who made it to our door. And we turned them away not because their cases lacked merit and not because there wasn't a legal remedy to be had. And we turned them away not because there weren't serious life-threatening issues at stake. We turned them away because we lacked resources. And I want to be real clear here. When I say we lacked resources, I mean we lacked attorneys to help. And you know, two or three times a year, there's a domestic violence murder that makes the front page of the newspaper in my community. And every single time that happens, I think to myself, I hope that wasn't somebody that we said no to, because that would be tragic. So now, you may be thinking, well, that's all very sad, and I'm so sorry about the state of things in Alaska, but really, what does that have to do with us? And the thing is, you know, the statistics in the lower 48 are nothing to be proud of either. We've heard these too, that 25% of women nationwide experience domestic violence and sexual assault. And again, as Professor Deer pointed out, Alaska Native and American Indian women are physically assaulted during their lifetimes at much higher rates than others. And we also know that the most vulnerable, those with the lowest incomes, are impacted at higher rates, and they're not going to be able to afford an attorney. And we also know that in the face of this, we know that most domestic violence incidents are not reported to the authorities. So, and with respect to legal aid challenges, every other legal aid provider I know of is facing the same problems we do. No matter how hard we try, we can't keep up with the demand for our services due to the chronic underfunding of our work. Here's a fun fact for you. Americans spend more money on Halloween costumes for their pets than is allocated by Congress annually to fund legal aid programs. True story. So working in legal aid is like drinking from a fire hose every single day. You can't keep up with the demand for your services. And across the board, all of my colleagues are turning people away one for one. And again, here are some more statistics that I think we've already heard, that within the Ninth Circuit, there were 15,000 requests for services in just a single day from domestic violence victims. And in the Ninth Circuit, 1 out of 8 victims were turned away from when they sought out some services. So the truth is, we need more lawyers to help with this. And in our community, we've been really lucky to have a really strong pro bono program. And so our 35 lawyers, our staff attorneys, in 1 year, we were able to gain an additional 118 private attorneys to jump in and help and volunteer and take on pro bono cases. They volunteered over 4,000 hours, and this is, we estimate, this is about $650,000 worth of donated services. These attorneys helped in a variety of ways. They took cases for the short or the long term. They consulted. They staffed community clinics. They answered helplines, and they helped drafting pro se forms. This, all of this helps us expand our reach and try to better address the needs of the community. But as I've said, we always need more help. And so we try to engage private attorneys to take on this work. We provide support and mentorship so that those of you who might not be familiar with this area of law have the resources you need to comfortably take on the cases. We host CLEs on a variety of topics to make sure that you're well-educated if you choose to volunteer for us. And we are constantly looking for more volunteers, those either seasoned bar members all the way to law students. We could use the help from any and all of them. And we're also really lucky that our State Bar Association supports pro bono and promotes our services, advertising pro bono opportunities through their website and newsletters, and provides us with places to make a pitch, like this one. And they also approve CLE credits for volunteer trainings. And our judiciary is also incredibly supportive of the need for pro bono. Our judiciary attends swearing-in ceremonies, so that when new members of the bar are being sworn in, they're getting information immediately about the importance of doing pro bono work. And our judiciary also gives welcome remarks at receptions we have where we're thanking our volunteers for their good work and for coming to the table and in recognizing their volunteer service. And for this, we are very grateful. And I can tell you that it makes a huge, huge difference. And again, another thing that we tried in 2010, our state attorney general wanted to raise awareness about the need to address domestic violence and also the way that legal aid could help. And so we started doing, over the last 10 years, community summits in all of the communities, in hub communities. And we partner with domestic violence shelters and other nonprofits addressing domestic violence to have a day related to domestic violence and also let them know that pro bono helps and civil legal aid helps. So I'm hoping for those of you who are lawyers, now that you know more about this problem and the unique role that those of us in the legal profession can play in addressing it, that you'll be motivated to act. And I also want to give you some resources to do just that. If you're an attorney, I hope you'll reach out to the legal aid providers in your state or region and see how you can volunteer through the pro bono program. All of the LSC-funded organizations, in which there's one in every state, California has 11 and Arizona has 3, all have pro bono programs that support volunteers throughout their community. And if you're a judge, I hope that you will get in touch with those legal aid organizations or others too, and encourage members of the bar to volunteer their time, because I assure you, people will listen to you. Thank you.
In order to help us comply with this new law, the Circuit Executive's Office has created a link to assist all the districts in the Ninth Circuit find the resources needed to develop programs focusing on the need for pro bono attorneys to represent DV victims. This tool provides domestic abuse resources throughout the 15 districts of the Ninth Circuit, as well as a toolkit designed to make planning your events easier. In addition to pinpointing existing resources, the tribal organizations that are accessible to Native American victims of abuse are all noted. The circuit's website also includes a link to the reporting tool developed by the AO to enable districts to report on the programs they have presented.